Welcome to worship. My name is Heidi Henkel. I'm the pastor of Bethesda Presbyterian Church, and it's a joy to worship with you today. We have a few announcements before we begin our service. Next Monday, November 23rd, we need any poinsettia orders, and we need your Christmas well wishes to be printed in the December newsletter. So the deadline for your Christmas well wishes in place of Christmas cards and your poinsettia orders need to be in by next Monday, the 23rd. If you need any help, please contact our administrator, Margie Johnson. Next Sunday, November 23rd, we're having another virtual dinner and game night. These are a lot of fun. We get to laugh together. We definitely have great fellowship. So we invite you to join us next Sunday at 5 p.m. for dinner, 5:30 for games. It is a wonderful time. It's on our Zoom link. You can call in on a phone and participate, or you can log in through a device. But we just, we'd love to have you join us and be a part of that fellowship. Today, let's begin by centering ourselves in the presence of God, by allowing him to dwell in us richly, and by giving God all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. Let's begin. Join me in our call to worship. God was with the people of Israel when they left Egypt. God is with us now. God gave the people hope as they traveled through the desert. God gives us the courage to step out in faith. God is with us wherever we go. Come, let us worship the Lord. Jesus, as we enter worship with you today, we give you all the praise and all the honor. Not only have you led us, not only have you died for us, you continue to inspire our faith. You continue to challenge us to know you in a deeper way and to love the people around us in deeper ways. Challenge us with today's word. Help us to look deeper and understand your heart for us and for this world. As we draw near through prayer, through song, and through scripture, transform us that you might transform the world through us. We ask this in your name. Come, Holy Spirit. Amen. Join me in our opening song this morning.
Glorious in heaven above.
Join me in our prayer of confession today. Lord, we know who you are. We know you bring the kingdom of heaven. But when you assign us the job of lighting the way, we barely announce your divine rule to ourselves. Our worship hour has solemn times and festivals, and we celebrate your redemptive action in history with our calendar, Sundays, seasons, year after year. Yet we become drowsy, unprepared, because we are not disciples each day at all hours. Those times we live for ourselves. We do not need you right now. So we do not want justice unless we judge for ourselves, and self-righteousness is easier than right relationship. Forgive us, Lord, the sins we can bear to name, and save us, Lord, from the sins we will not speak. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. God redeems. Our hope lives in the one we call Jesus the Christ. For Christ's sake, our sins are forgiven. May the flood of God's love in Jesus be poured out in our lives each day. Amen. Let's give God all the glory and honor today for our offering. God, today we lay down our hearts, we lay down our lives. We give you our gifts, our talents, our skills, our resources, all that you first gave us. We pray, multiply them and use them for the mission and ministry of your kingdom here on earth in the communities around us. Bless this that we give today. Amen.
Welcome to Kids Time. Let's listen closely to hear God's word for us today. We're going to read a really special book today. And just to start out, we have a nice, very hungry caterpillar. Oh my gosh. I'm going to put him right here next to you, Zoe. Be careful, he doesn't eat you. Okay. All right. The Very Hungry Caterpillar by Eric Carle. That's what we're reading today. In the light of the moon lay a little egg on a leaf. And one Sunday morning, the warm sun came up and pow, out of the egg came a tiny and very hungry caterpillar. He started to look for some food. No food there. On Monday, he ate through one apple, but he was still hungry. On Tuesday, he ate through two pears, but he was still hungry. On Wednesday, he ate through three plums, but he was still hungry. On Thursday, he ate through four strawberries, but he was still hungry. On Friday, he ate through five oranges, but he was still hungry. On Saturday, he ate through one piece of chocolate cake, one ice cream cone, one pickle, one slice of Swiss cheese, one slice of salami, that's right, one lollipop, one piece of cherry pie, one sausage, one cupcake, and one slice of watermelon. And that night, he had a stomach ache. Look at all that food. Oh my goodness. The next day was Sunday again, and the caterpillar ate through one nice green leaf. And after that, he felt better. Now he wasn't hungry anymore, and he wasn't a little caterpillar anymore. He was a big, fat caterpillar. And he built a small house called a cocoon all around himself. He stayed inside for more than 2 weeks, and then he nibbled a hole in the cocoon, and he pushed his way out, and he was a beautiful butterfly. Can we show everybody? Can we show everybody a beautiful butterfly? Wow. Some things in life transform, including you and I, and even a caterpillar. We can transform into something different. And today we're going to hear about a woman that led the nation of Israel. Her name was Deborah. And she led them during a hard time and helped them to transform into a nation that listened. She was part of that process. I'm wondering today, if you could change something about yourself, what might it be? If you wanted to do something differently, what would it be? Well, Deborah wanted to listen to God, no matter how much the people around her were upset with her, no matter how much they wanted to hear a different word, she stayed true to God. She just wanted to be truthful to God. So when people asked her to speak a different word, she stayed quiet. And when people asked her to leave, when she didn't feel called to leave, she stayed home. Her prayer and desire was to follow God completely. And because she listened to him, God not only transformed her into a leader of a nation, he helped her to transform the entire group of Israelites to bring them into a new time. So I invite you this week to think about how God might be teaching you new things and might be helping you transform situations around you. Maybe he'll use you to help take care of another neighbor or help to take care of people in your house. Maybe he'll use you to pray for somebody else. Maybe he'll use you to be a listener, just like Deborah, to listen to other people, to hear what they have to say, and then to pray to God for them. Whatever it is, always remember that you might be a little caterpillar, but God is working on all of us to make us beautiful butterflies. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we pray today that you would continue transforming us into beautiful people that you created us to be. We pray, God, that you would help us to listen to you, to read your word, to feed ourselves with your Bible teachings. We pray, help us to love one another in the same way that you loved us, so that we might transform through Jesus. We ask this in your name. Amen. Thanks for joining us for Kids Time today. We invite you to join us in our next hymn.
Our scripture reading comes from the book of Judges, chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. Hear the word of God from the book that we love. Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, now that Ehud was dead. So the Lord sold them into the hands of Jabin, king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. Sisera, the commander of his army, was based in Haroseth Hagoyim. Because he had 900 chariots fitted with iron and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years, they cried to the Lord for help. Now Deborah, a prophet, the wife of Lapidoth, was leading Israel at the time. She held court under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites went up to her to have their disputes decided. She sent for Barak, son of Abinoam, from Kadesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun and lead them up to Mount Tabor. I will lead Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops to the Kishon River and give him into your hands." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Welcome once again. You know, I don't know about you, but in moments throughout the week, sometimes I find myself struggling. I find myself having a hard time believing in some pieces of my faith. It might be surprising to hear from a pastor today, but I'm human just like you. And I'm trying to be honest and transparent today because that's what God calls us to do with our hearts and our lives. It's not easy to be a believer of Christ. It's not easy. It means that we have to get up every day and choose God. We have to choose Him over and over and over again in every decision that we make. It means we have to believe in the impossible. It means we have to believe in things so much greater than we could ever imagine. It means living in a way contrary to this world. It means living in a very upside down, backwards way. And if we're really honest with ourselves, when our feet hit the floor in the morning, and even sometimes before that, we doubt. We doubt what God's doing. We doubt ourselves. We doubt the world around us. But we're not alone. We are not alone. We're going to take a look at a particular time in Israel's history in which they were in doubt. Doubt of who God was, in doubt of what He had promised them, and they are in exile. So let's dive into our text today and see what God can speak to us through His word. We are in the time of the judges. And to give you clarity in that, Israel had moved into the land and began to settle into this promised land that God had brought them to, and they were being led by Joshua during that time. They had won many battles at that point, and as they settled in the land, they do what we do, not just Israel, but what we do. They began to feel like their prosperity was their own. It's, well, this is my land, and my house, and my riches. And they began to take it and put it where they wanted to, and idolatry became rampant in the land. And so God, in response, put them into exile. The God that led them to that very promised land allowed another power to come in and take them over. And so during the time of the judges, Israel is under the authority of Canaan. Canaan, the land of Canaan, had conquered where the Israelites had settled. And they are in prisons in their own cities. It's the best way to describe it. That Canaan has posted guards all the way around the cities, and the people are not free to come and go as they please. And so within the city, they are at the mercy of the authority to give them food from the land around, to give them the goods that they need. And at this moment, Israel has lost its faith in the God that brought them out of slavery. Now, as I have shown you throughout many different times, God does not leave the Israelites without someone that he's speaking to. Even when they were in slavery and under oppression, God raises up a leader for them in Moses. Even when they're wandering through the desert, they have a leader in Moses and Aaron. Even as they're moving into the new land and fighting battles, they are led by Joshua. And even as they go through the time of judgment, when they are in exile, God raises up several judges. You may have heard of Samson before, who's one of the judges. But today we're going to hear about one of the judges named Deborah. They are in exile here. They are separated from the prosperity that God had promised them. They are under the authority of another country. They just escaped from Egypt years ago, and now here they're under another power's authority. But God does not leave them without a leader, and he chooses Deborah. He chooses Deborah to be his person, to be the one whom he will speak to and communicate with. She is a prophetess, but she's also a judge. So she's considered a prophetess because she is the one whom God chooses to speak with. A person who carries the testimony of God carries the spirit of prophecy. We see that in Revelation. It says the spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Christ. So Deborah is the one who speaks with God, but she's also a judge in the land. That tells us that she is a person of wisdom and discernment. It tells us that she is highly respected in the land, that people bring their disputes to her to have her issue judgment. She sits at the edge of the land, it says, under this palm tree, and that's where people come when they need her to issue a judgment. Now, as she is going about her regular time, her regular day, sitting under that palm tree, dealing with the people of Israel, God gives her a message. And God says that he is going to deliver a victory through the commander of the Israelite army, Barak. This man, Barak. So here we see God has chosen Deborah to be the person that he speaks to, and then he chooses an army commander that has no army, that he's going to deliver a victory through. It's fascinating. Sometimes we think that we can decide, you know, who God can speak through. We put limits on it, and yet God chooses the people in his day whom he will speak through. So Deborah goes to Barak, an army commander, and she says to him, "Listen, Sisera, who is Canaan's head of their army, Sisera is going to march an army to this area right near the Kishon River, the Kishon Valley." And she says to Barak, "God has said, if you take the army down there to fight, he's going to give you the victory, and he's going to give Israel the victory." Now, in this moment, which is not part of our text today, but it completes the story, Barak says to her, "Well, I can't go without you." Think about that. I can't go without you. Now, this would not be an out-of-sort comment for Barak, When Joshua and Moses dealt with any type of battle, they always had some type of the presence of God with them. For Moses, it was the cloud and the fire. For Joshua, it was the Ark of the Covenant. Somehow, the presence of God always went with them into battle, and that's what assured them the win. So Barak saying to Deborah, the person who God is choosing to speak with, you know, you have to come with us, and, you know, that'll give us the confidence to go. We know there'll be a victory. But that's not the word that God had spoken to Deborah, and that's not the word that she had communicated to Barak. And so in that moment, Deborah said to him, I will go with you. But because you've chosen to take me instead of trusting in God's word to you, he's going to give the death of Sisera to somebody else. The death of the opposing army commander was the point of the victory. Having that honor lifted you in the eyes of the warriors that day. So to take that away from Barak also says he is not going to be hailed as the strong man after this. But I just want to pause in this moment here. Barak has a lack of confidence. And in that moment, it's a lack of faith in this word that God has given. Have you ever had that in your life? That lack of confidence, that lack of faith? Where God says he is going to do something, where God has given you a promise that he is walking with you, but you don't see him. Where God says he will deliver you, but you just haven't seen that deliverance yet. Where you feel like God has spoken to you a word of healing, but you don't see it yet. You're not alone. You're not alone. And even here, even the strongest people in Israel, Barak, a strong army commander, even he at that moment has a lack of faith. He has seen victory after victory before with Israel, before the exile. He saw these victories. And Barak is just, he can't believe it. Not unless the presence of God goes with them. The word for us today is, even when we don't feel the presence of God, even when we don't see it, that doesn't mean that God isn't there. It doesn't mean that God isn't with you and I in the midst of what we're dealing with. And just because our lives aren't prosperous, or maybe just because we are under oppression, it doesn't mean that God isn't there. If you are in a place of incredible suffering today, I want you to hear me very clearly. You are not alone. You are not alone. And God knows exactly what it is to carry that burden because he walked this life through Christ, who endured incredible suffering and pain. God's presence goes with us when his word leads us. See, our faith has to have legs to it. Faith is your belief with legs on it. So it's our faith is to be acted out. It's not just receiving the word and then not doing anything. I remember a time I was teaching a confirmation class to young people, and we were talking about hearing the word of God, just praying and hearing the word of God. And so I had challenged them to pray over the week, and at the next confirmation class, we were going to ask the question, you know, what have you felt God saying to you? Or what have you felt God maybe convicting you of inside? And so the next week we had our class and I asked them, and one of the students had said, well, I felt God saying to me that, you know, I really need to start working with some of the kids in my class that are struggling in chemistry class with me. And I need to start working with them instead of being so happy that I'm getting great grades, you know, I need to start helping them. And I thought, that's really great. And I said, that's great. How did the kids receive that word when you offered help to them? And the student stared at me and just said, oh, I never actually did it. And we all kind of had a good chuckle around the room because that is exactly what happens to you and I. We get so excited to feel like God is communicating us, that God is nudging us to go certain directions. We get so excited to hear the word, we never do anything about it. That's like going to a restaurant and reading the menu and then never trying the food. Faith has got to have legs to it. It's got to have belief plus the legs that go and do the work. We're called to go into the world to make disciples. So as we hear the word of God, we have to also have the faith to walk out that word of God. Now, as you are hearing this today, if you're feeling like, I don't know about that, Pastor Heidi, it's okay. Barak felt the same way too. He heard this word that somehow he was going to have to go and raise this large army from people who were depressed, who were in exile, that somehow he was going to raise a large army and go fight Sisera with incredible odds. So he says this word to Deborah, if you go with me, we'll be able to raise the army that we need. And she does. She follows through on her word. She goes with Barak. They are able to raise the army that they need. They go down and they meet Sisera's army. And indeed, God does deliver a victory into their hand. But, Sisera flees the battlefield, and tries to tell other people along the way that he's somebody else. He doesn't want people to know that he's Sisera because he knows that his life will end. And so he asks for a place to stay as he comes across this tent, and they take him in, and they realize that it is Sisera, and it is the wife that kills Sisera that day. A wife. She probably wasn't known by many at all. She had no authority, probably had no voice and power at that point in time too. But she's the one who conquers the opposing commander. God can work through anybody, even someone who thinks they're a nobody. If you are feeling like today God can't work through you, take a look at our story. God took a woman and rose her to authority, into a place and a seat of being a judge, into a place and a seat of carrying wisdom and discernment to be the voice of God to this nation during a time when women had no voice and no power and couldn't own property. God raises up an army commander who's been defeated over and over again by Canaan, and this time he delivers a victory. And God uses a woman out there in a bit of the wilderness to be the one that actually delivers the opposing army's death into Israel's hands. It is an odd group of characters through this entire story. But it doesn't matter what's happening out there in the world. It doesn't even matter what's necessarily happening in the areas around us, because God is working through us today. God is working through you and through I. And no matter how bad things are, God is present with us. And he chooses to constantly move through you and I to challenge those powers and those principalities in our world. Let's be clear, those powers and those principalities are not people. Those powers and principalities are these dark forces that affect humanity. Things like division and derision. Things like lies and deceit. These powers and principalities are the language of Satan. They are the language of Satan, and he is hard at work behind the scenes with all of humanity, not just a group that maybe you don't like. Satan is at work behind all of humanity, doing his best to infect us all, to get us to bow down to these powers and principalities, these forces in which deeply take us away from the heart of God. which cause us to act in a way that is contrary to the kingdom of God. And so we are called today to take a step in faith, a step to believe in the impossible, that today God chooses us, that today God is going to work through us, and that today God is going to empower you and I to go and do exactly where he is leading us and calling us to go. Today, rise up, my friends, for your faith is your belief with your legs on it. So let's go and do as God commands. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you remind us once again that you are with us. And as you call us to go out, to love on people, to go out, to care for people, to go out, to notice people, to lift people up, to encourage one another, that you are with us. We pray today, give us courage, give us boldness. Let us know, God, that you are near us, even when we can't see you or feel you. Help us to see the fruit of the things and the labor we do, that your kingdom might give all the honor and all the glory and all the praise. We ask this in your name. Amen. I invite you to reflect on our word today through this song.
Never failing, let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. So Savior, Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Fears and failures, Lord, fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. So now I surrender. Oh, we surrender. Savior, you can move the mountains. Conquer the grave.
Let's confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's lift our community in prayer to God. God, in whose love we live and move, we pray for a world crying out to feel loved, wanted, and cherished and unique. Source of all love, we pray for a world torn apart by conflict and war, a world that lives uneasily in a climate of fear with no clear vision for future days. Source of all hope, we pray for a world that thinks less of others than of self. A world where division between nations, race, religion, neighbor, and family leads to distrust and even oppression. Source of all peace, we pray for a world that is short on happiness, too busy to enjoy this world you have created, too preoccupied with living to appreciate life. Source of all joy, we pray for a world where spiritual longing is satisfied by fashionable notions and temporary solutions with no thought for tomorrow. Source of our salvation, we pray for a world that needs to know your love and your hope, your peace, your joy and salvation. A world that needs to know it is special, unique, and uniquely loved by you. We lift those on our hearts and minds today to you. And we ask for your intercession. You have been faithful yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And we lift these prayers in expectation of your answer. We give you all the praise and glory. You have walked with us through the hard times and through the wonderful times, God. And we know that these situations that we give you today, that we place in your hands, you are already at work and already present with all those involved. We spend this moment of silence as we pray to you. Hear our prayers today, God. We entrust them to you, and we pray using the words you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to join in singing our closing hymn today.
Come, all Christians, be committed to the service of the courts with gladness, each his sacred vows renew. Turn away from sin and sadness, be transformed with life anew. Of your time and talents give me, they are gifts from God above, to be used by Christians freely, to proclaim his wondrous love.
May you go forth today as the people of God into his creation. May you bring his heart with you into every situation. May you speak the words of Christ. And may you demonstrate the radical, salvific love that God has offered for all of us. May you turn suffering and redeem it for joy. May you take the situations of sin and repent, that they may be redeemed for God's glory. In all things, may you be the light of the world, the hope of Christ, with the Spirit who lives in you this day. Amen. We want to thank you for joining us for worship, and we pray you have a blessed day. Thank you.